I'm really happy to have this brainstorming session because it's a special one. It is a project that it will be sharing the work that we our internship team has done, and our various interns are here, and the three interns that we've had for 2021, and also as Kenneth has mentioned, the ICOMOS Philippines interns are also coming. So before we begin, I would like to introduce our team. So the internship team is actually part of the SDG, the Working Group Task Team 7, which is funding human resource and internships. The task team engages with partners to provide financial, technological, and human resources to support the engagement of the working group on transversal issues and heritage and the SDGs. It also facilitates the working group's internship program, which we are discussing today, and to engage emerging professionals with opportunities to work with experts to develop SDG-related research. So I'm very happy because the two task team coordinators, Anasha and Adaria, have also done internships before under the US ICOMOS IEP program. And Anasha has done her internship with EGID in 2019, and I think Laria has done hers in the city of San Antonio in the US. So I really thank both ICOMOS International and also US ICOMOS for making this happen. The Task Team 7, I've mentioned this before in our annual general meeting, that we also are looking at the other aspect, which is funding. And there are items that I've mentioned in our meeting, which is monies coming in from, we've now set up a line item at the ICOMOS International Treasury for the SDGs working group. And hopefully money will come in soon with the World Monuments Watch reviews that have happened. Arab Regional Center for World Heritage Workshops in 2021, which will also continue in 2022. And the potential of GHF project will be activated soon. And I do hope that if you're interested with funds and to see how all these happen at the background, you also join Task Team 7. Both Inasha and Ilaria are part, and Osgun as well, are part of another task team on funding called the Funding Inventory Team from the EPWG, which is, I think this is a natural link to another working group. So we hope that you can join us. So as generally in brainstorming sessions, I always say this, that the objective of the brainstorming session is to listen to various perspectives on how we integrate heritage and sustainable development. And this is not an official meeting. It is a time for sharing of knowledge and ideas and principles to be aligned. So feel free to really ask questions, and and we will manage that, the timing for you. It is a time also to test out ideas and improve our ways of working as a working group, and learn, share, and co-create knowledge. So our interns have done that with their mentors, and I do hope that you also provide your inputs to our interns so to enrich the knowledge that has been created. So it is an informal space. I'm making this a little bit formal in the beginning, but of course we can all discuss later on. Yeah. So the internship today will be discussing about the internship research, and Anasha and Ilaria will be providing us first information, and then Lydia, Loopesko, and Ameneh, Karimian, who will be providing their discussions on their research. And we will discuss after the, and I think US ICOMOS is also here, the IEP program, so they can tell about the internship. And as usual, we will also have our NC and ISC presentations from ICOMOS Korea, and today ICTC. So I will end here, and then I will have Adaria and Anasha share the screens for the internship program.
All right. Great, we'll get started then. Thank you, first of all, everyone, for coming. It's wonderful to see you. I'm so happy you could be here to support our internship program. The interns will be presenting, our mentors. Thank you to US ICOMOS, who will be here to speak about their IEP program, which has been very generous in supporting our interns. We've launched this program this year, and we're really excited to share this panel with you. So without further ado, I'll just get started. Kick us off with our agenda. As you saw in the introduction to in Gabe's link for the invite, we are dividing this internship panel into two different parts. The first part will be a quick introduction to the program and what we intend to do, what we have been doing with it so far. Then we will go to our two presentations with Lydia and Ameneh. I will let you know when you have 1 minute left, and for the interest of everyone else's presentation, we will try to keep the time as best as possible. Then we will move on to our second part, the discussion part, where our current intern who just started, Tanya, will just give a 5 minute introduction of herself, what her research is. We will hear from the mentors of Lydia and Ameneh on their experience in the internship program. And then we are very happy to have Zoe Lung from the US ICOMOS, who is the internship exchange program, their chair, will speak a bit about their program. And then we will leave some time for Q&A. So if you do have some questions, please jot them down or maybe keep them in the chat, and we will get to them during our Q&A session. And with that, I will hand it over to you, Ilaria.
Yeah. Well, hello, everyone. Maybe before we can give a short introduction about ourselves, I mean, we all know each other. Just, well, as Gab said, I'm part of Task Team 7, also part of Task Team 1 within the SDGs Working Group. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Antwerp, working on participation in heritage and sustainable development. Anasha, do you want to say something about your background, since today we have some external guests?
Sure, absolutely. Hello, everyone. My name is Anasha Srinivasan. I am a part of Task Team 7. I am the SDG's Emerging Professionals Representative to the EPWG. I am also a part of Task Team 6 and most recently a part of Task Team 1. So very excited to get involved with all of the SDG Working Group's different task teams and initiatives. I'm a member of US ICOMOS. And outside of ICOMOS, I work in international development and I work on sustainable tourism and cultural heritage programs. And really work at the intersection of cultural heritage protection and economic development.
Great, thank you, Anasha. to give a brief introduction of the program, many of you already heard about it a few weeks ago during our annual general meeting. So the internship program was launched this year and it seeks to provide ICOMOS emerging professionals to work closely with heritage practitioners within the SDGs working group to develop research deliverables, grow their networks within and outside ICOMOS through ICOMOS members, and assist the SDGs working group in achieving the action agenda for the upcoming triennium. The program runs throughout summer and fall, and it aims to pair mentors from, as we said, from the SDGs working group with emerging professionals for a period that can included between 3 and 6 months. So the projects can vary. And they can have different scopes indeed, but the most important thing is that they all relate to the topics of heritage and sustainable development somehow and contribute to the work of one or multiple SDGs working group task teams. We like to stress the fact that we're very happy that the internship is paid. It's a paid initiative. It is not something very common in our field, and we're very proud of this. And for this, we need to thank both the ICOMOS Secretariat, who is supporting the initiative manager point of view and from a financial point of view, and the US ICOMOS International Exchange Program, as both Anasha and Gabe have already mentioned, and of course other partners that we are talking, we're in a conversation with in order to make this internship program financially sustainable in the long term. The compensation of the interns varies according to the time and place of the placement, and of course to the type of funding. And back to you, Anasha, and to the rest of the presentation. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Ilaria. We'll be hearing more from you later, I'm sure. I just wanted to give a quick snapshot of our next steps for this program. Ilari and I are really excited that we're going to be continuing it and continuing it for next year. So she and I, as the intern coordinators, we will share a report of our findings and our learnings from this year with the rest of the working group and how we plan to improve and change the program moving forward. So we have been, our interns and our mentors have been very kind to be providing a lot of feedback to us during this process. It's been learning for us as we've been trying to support them as much as possible. So we want to be as transparent as possible with this program, with our learnings, invite input, invite comment. We really want to make this the best experience it can be for our interns. And so if you are able to read our report and you have some comments, please share them back with us. We'd really appreciate reading your thoughts. Secondly, our task team 7 is beginning to launch a 6-month fundraising strategy plan to support future mentorship and endeavors, to support future interns, and also just have a way for the SDGs working to be self-sustaining. We're really excited about this initiative, and if you're interested in this at all, please let us know. We'd love to work with you. And finally, we will be launching our call for mentors by the end of this year to get a head start on our placements for the summer and the fall for 2022. We will then be following up with our call for interns in the early part of 2022. So if you're interested in this program, participating in it in any way, look out for our call. We'll be excited to have you and hear your applications. Without further ado then, I will turn it over to our first presenter, Lydia. I understand that you'll be sharing your slides with us directly. I will give you, I'll just jump in at the 1 minute mark when it's time to wrap things up, but otherwise floor is yours.
Excellent, thank you, yes. So as mentioned, I am one of the interns. My name is Lydia. I've worked with some of you over the course of the internship, which was under Gabe. And it looked specifically at integrating climate action and the SDGs in World Heritage. So there is a lot of discussion of climate action in World Heritage sites, a lot of discussion of how the SDGs are implemented in World Heritage sites. But considering the urgency of both discussions, there's very little discussion of how to integrate them. And so my specific question was, how do you integrate them with a specific focus on World Heritage Site management? So my research fell under two main policies, the World Heritage Climate Change Policy, which looks at four main themes: assessing climate risks, using those risks to inspire climate adaptation, mitigation, and then also the key role that World Heritage can play is knowledge sharing, capacity building, and raising awareness. And this falls under the sustainable development policy, which says that actions for climate change should contribute to the implementation of the SDGs or sustainable development as a whole. And so that climate action is, so sustainable development policy is an umbrella for climate change, for the climate change policy. And the climate sustainable development policy has four main, looks at sustainable development rather than as the SDGs, as the four main pillars of sustainable development being economic, social, environmental, and governance. So I began by first looking at the state of conservation reports to understand what are the threats that World Heritage sites are facing. And so the database has 12 tags. Has many tags, and I found 12 of which to be associated with climate change. Now, these 12 tags affected a total of 146 sites, and you can see there's a wide distribution of all the sites affected, but also a wide variety of sites, more of them cultural than natural, and that's because there are more cultural sites than natural sites, but also that natural sites have a more inherent resilience. So of these 146 sites, I then chose 16 that were the most affected by climate change. They had the most threats associated with them, and then looked deeper into the state of conservation reports to see what was being done about that. So in terms of wildfire and drought, there really was a focus on changing behaviors, changing water use, reducing fires, controlling fires. But for some of the other threats, there was really a focus on infrastructure, planting trees, creating shelters to protect from rainwater, and improving drainage, which was something that was very important for flooding, but also just general repair, reinforcement, and just ensuring better maintenance of the sites to withstand some of the threats of climate change. And then for the slow onset events, there wasn't much that could be done other than just creating weather stations and monitoring the site to inform disaster risk reduction plans. So I then looked at four case studies. These were based on the availability of the ICOMOS network that I could get a hold in, and also within the time, 3 months. So it is a limited section, but I tried to get two that were in the geographic north, two in the global north and global south, and then two cultural sites and two mixed sites. So I have the Sydney Opera House, a cultural site in Sydney, in Australia, and then the city of Lyon in the south of France, and then Machu Picchu, a mixed landscape based on the tangible cultural heritage ruins. And then Pimochau and Aki, which is a site in Canada that is a natural site based, but with also the intangible cultural values of the First Nations that protect the site. So with these case studies, I first looked at all of the management plans and looked at all of the actions in those management plans and what they were and how they mapped to the actions in the future or pasts. As most of you will know, the future or pasts is an ICOMOS document that enumerates all the many things that the heritage community can do for climate action. So using that to map, to kind of inform how the management plans correlated with those was a good way of understanding how they correlated to climate action. And then how both of those combined then mapped to the different SDGs to really see the integration of all three. And then I conducted site manager interviews with each of the site managers, and those were looking at what was their actions towards climate change, sustainability, and how those integrated. And then those same questions were then asked of higher level experts in the field of disaster risk reduction, sustainability, climate change, and heritage. And that was really to see if the lower level discussions, the local level discussions, matched higher level discussions where there was an overlap. So the main results, it's a rather confusing chart, but these are the number of actions in each of the management plans that map to both climate action and sustainable development. So there was a very large focus on educating the public and building awareness. And this was seen as the main thing that World Heritage Sites could do. And that was very much shown in the actions that they took, but also a big focus on creating resilient governance that would be flexible and adaptable for climate change and sustainability. And then a big focus on involving the community and involving them in any decision-making. But climate change was specifically mentioned in all of the sites. Now, two of the management plans I looked at were climate-specific, or at least environment-specific, but to the other, when there was more than one action plan, management plan. However, for two of the sites, there was only one management plan, and climate change was specifically mentioned in both of those. And then there was a big focus on partnerships, specifically to understand climate change and build a plan of what to do. And then a big focus on resilient infrastructure, as evidenced in the state of conservation reports. There was a big focus on reinforcing infrastructure and making sure that it withstands. And then also a big focus on reducing waste. So some of the key results of the interviews. So I interviewed a total of six higher level heritage professionals and then the four site managers. And so of these 10 interviewees, 50% highlighted the importance of governance and having a governance structure that was resilient and enabled to enact sustainable development. However, many agreed that climate action was still ad hoc and that only 60%, well, only most of them did speak to the importance of adaptation and particularly disaster risk management. But in terms of mitigation, it was a bit more varied. So 30% spoke of the importance of natural sites as carbon sinks. And then another 30% spoke to the importance of World Heritage cities as promoting ways of alternative of transport and energy. But there was very little discussion of any sites that felt not in either of those categories. And then there was no discussion of OUV, very little. However, there was general consensus that the SDGs do integrate well into climate actions, and that the main role that World Heritage can play is that of not raising awareness and knowledge sharing. So I just wanted to go through some of the actions that World Heritage sites are doing that involve both climate action and sustainable development. So for the Pimochawan Aki, they have been conducting periodic needs assessment to understand the needs of their of the communities and see if those needs are changing based on climate change and ensuring that they have that they have what they need. For Zero Hunger, Machu Picchu has been promoting the use of higher yield land rather than encroaching onto the surrounding forest, promoting raising awareness of the use of the land that there is rather than involving newer land, and that prevents deforestation and protects the environment. In terms of well-being, the city of Lyon is at high risk of heat waves in the summer. And so to counter that, they have been opening parks at night and promoting green transport to kind of ensure a healthier lifestyle for their citizens. And as I said, education was a big role. All of them had many different actions, but I couldn't put everything down. So the Sydney Opera House really saw itself in a leadership position, and they used their platform of cultural events to promote better understanding of sustainability and climate action, and really saw that as that what they could do as the as one of the things that they could do for climate action and sustainability. Gender, however, was one that was not very much addressed. The only instance of it was in the Pimochawan Aki management plan, which had a women's forum very much involved in decision making about not only the World Heritage application, but also for any future changes related to management of the site, which would include climate change. And then in terms of reducing water, Lyon has been doing research into the effects of public fountains during heat waves, not only in the cooling effect that they have, but also in terms of harboring bacteria through stagnation during the summer months and how that affects hygiene. For affordable energy, Machu Picchu has been is trying to go carbon neutral and have only electric trains and buses by 2045, I believe. And for tourism and economy, Pimochawan Aki has been trying to develop ecotourism on the site as a way of getting more people to enjoy the site, but also to monitor on the ground. It's a very big site, lots of land, and that would be a way of kind of bringing people out and ensuring that there's more monitoring. In terms of infrastructure and industry, this was a big focus for kind of building up the infrastructure. But one of the things that Lyon has been doing is improving building renovations around the site. They have a lot of historic buildings, and those are some of the ones that are the most thermally efficient. And so promoting historic building methods as a way of improving thermal retention of buildings around the site and kind of reducing the effects of heat waves. In terms of inequalities, the Sydney Opera House have been working at promoting inclusive procurement, making sure that everything that they procure for the site is inclusive, for lack of a better word. In terms of sustainable communities, Lyon has created a climate action project fund, so that any community projects that are related to climate action, they have set aside a specific pot of money for those. For consumption, Machu Picchu has been looking at changing livestock, so moving away from cattle and more towards llamas and alpacas, which have a lower carbon footprint and are also more suited to the environment. The Sydney Opera House has been creating an artificial reef as a way of promoting marine biodiversity around the site. And Lyon has a nature plan where they are planting trees around the city, not only to promote biodiversity and have more nature in the city, but also as a way of tackling the urban heat island effect. And in terms of governance, Pimochawan Aki has a very inclusive governance structure that is mostly reliant on representation from each of the First Nations that inhabit the site. And they also have a guardian program where the First Nations are involved in monitoring the site and then reporting back to the governance structure for any changes that are required. And then there was a very big focus on research and partnering with research with academic institutions, universities, for greater understanding of what is going on the site, what is going on, what is climate change doing, and what can we do about it. So some of the key themes. First of all, there is an inherent connection between sustainable development and climate action. They involve very similar actions that very much integrate at the local level. Climate action is, however, still very ad hoc, with various levels of preparation on site. Three of the four sites had a disaster risk reduction plan. Some of them were much more focused on mitigation than others. It's still very ad hoc. It's not very cohesive. And that speaks to a greater need for cross-sectoral understanding of climate change, better communication between scientists, policymakers, site managers, so that there really is much more of a cohesive, unified strategy for climate change. And then with that could come sustainable development. So one of the things that came out in some of the interviews is, and something that we've spoken for before in discussions in ICOMOS, is that of an ecological transition, using a focus much more towards climate action, and then using that focus to then enable sustainable development, so that the climate action doesn't fall under the umbrella of sustainable development, but rather sustainable development, climate action comes first and foremost, and then with that later comes sustainable development, one being kind of the catalyst for the other. And I found this, considering the two the timelines, sustainable development in terms of the SDGs has a finite goal, 2030, at least in terms of the policy. Climate action, however, does not. And in that way, it's much more pressing. And so using climate action to implement sustainable development seems to be a way that many of the sites are looking at it, and a much more efficient way of doing it. And that's it from me. Thank you. And I look forward to any questions that you may have. Back to you, Anasha.
Thank you so much, Lydia. Huge round of applause for you. Huge appreciation for your work. You've done a tremendous presentation, one that's going to be really useful for a lot of people. And we've had a fantastic time working with you, and we look forward to working with you more in the future. So please join me in giving a round of applause, virtually or otherwise, to Lydia.
Thank you.
Great. Well, moving right along. Yeah, a lot of the applause coming in. Nice. Thank you. I will share my screen again for Ameneh's presentation. Ameneh, are you here?
So my name is Ameneh. I started my internship in August under the supervision of Linda. My project is titled Localizing the Sustainable Development Goals Policy Guidance. It was based on the policy guidance that was published a few months ago by ICOMOS SDG Working Group. The project tried to take the first steps in transforming the policy statements into effective and measurable actions. It tried to present a framework for the qualitative and quantitative assessment of the contribution of heritage projects to the SDGs. I started by a very brief literature review, and you can see some of the documents I found in this area. These documents were selections of efforts during the 12-year time span that integrated culture and cultural and natural heritage and sustainable development agenda. All of them have developed sets of indicators to evaluate the success of this integration. Most of the indicators are statistical, yet some of them are qualitative data and evidence-based. Most of in the, I tried to anchor this project in these previous attempts and experiences. The objective of the project was, the main objective was assessing heritage projects' contribution to the SDGs. And to this end, it tried to develop some indicators. During the process, I tried to provide some recommendations on some of the policy statements as well. And finally, I tried to identify some case studies for testing the indicators. The methods are used were literature review, survey, and case studies. In general, the following steps were undertaken in this research. Studying and reviewing the existing publications, developing the SMART indicators, designing a set of questions, prioritizing the goals, the SDG goals, of course, designing a survey, identifying case studies, sharing the survey, analyzing data, extracting the lessons learned, and building up a dossier of best practices. As I mentioned, I tried to provide some recommendations as well. I proposed two concepts to be included in the policy statements, and they were as they were significantly important in both sustainable development and heritage conservation. These were GIOS and HVO. My suggestion was to include GIOS in under the goal 2 as follows. Identify, document, support, and safeguard GIOS and their livelihoods, agricultural and associated biodiversity, landscapes, knowledge systems, and culture. And I also suggested to include HUL under the policy guidance for the goal 11. Recognition of the UNESCO historic urban landscape approach at the national level to increase the sustainability of planning and design interventions by taking into account the existing built environments, intangible heritage, cultural diversity, socioeconomic and environmental factors, along with local community values. The SDG indicators, those developed by the UN, are all aimed for numeric data type to ensure a fair comparison and better monitoring and evaluation. And therefore, I also tried in this research to design a numeric indicators as well. However, in some cases where the concepts were broadly abstract, the quantitative data could not be developed. Here, the indicators and questions for policy statements are presented for the first goal. I did this for all the 17 goals and developed indicators and then questions for every single policy statement. A basic set of questions was first drafted for all the policy statements. The indicators when then designed for all the questions, and then after several revisions, the questions were finalized. Here is an example of the process. As you can see, it was developed for the policy statement goal 12, and it is the fifth statement. I won't go into detail because I don't have much time. After that, similar questions under each SDG were combined. The questions were initially designed in two types. They were either multiple choices or checkboxes. As you can see, an example of each type is presented here. In both types and for all questions in the survey, a text box was considered for providing qualitative and quantitative answers. In front of each question, it is indicated which policy statement it refers to. A major challenge of the project was the scope of the work and limited time. So Although at first it was frightening with all the SDGs and the survey, soon we realized that it's not possible. Accordingly, we decided to focus on a limited number of SDGs. To do so, we had to identify those goals that were addressed the most in heritage practices. So during my research, I found a website named Agenda 21 Culture Good Practices with over 200 case studies that address SDGs in their heritage projects. This became the base of my work, and I used the case studies further. I retrieved the information from each case concerning their geographical context and the SDGs they addressed. Seven regions were considered. It was tried to cover the less represented region in this project. This table, this one shows the title of the project, the country, and the SDGs they addressed. Those that are highlighted in yellow are the project that I will explain later, that we actually received the survey form back. They fill the survey and turn it back to us. Here is the distribution of the regions, and it's it shows each project belongs to what regions. So here you can see in the second table, you can see the number of the SDGs that the projects were addressing. As you can see, the goal 11 was the most cited goals, followed by goal 10, goal 17, 9, 8, 12, and 4. We have chosen to exclude goal 11 since it was already addressed in many studies. Next, we had to choose our case studies from 210 presented cases. To do so, we considered two criteria, geographical distribution and number of SDGs they address. So in the third and fourth table, we can see the final case studies that were selected based on their geographical distribution and the SDGs they address. In total, more than 70 emails were sent, and I don't know, maybe over 100 follow-up emails, from which 48 were delivered. By the end of October, we have received 8 field forms. The information of their projects are listed in this table. Here you can see the survey form, and the left is the first page, the second page. I just go over it. Okay. This is the first question. And the answers were received for this question. The received answers are presented in the forms of either a donut chart for multiple choices or column chart for checkbox choices. So this is, I know it's not readable. I just wanted to show the format of the work I've done for each of the questions. The first column shows the name of the project. The second is the answers they selected, and the third column is the answers they provided. They were their written answers. I will read the answers for this question as a sample, just quickly. 7,500 claim that their activities enhance the variety of learning environments, contents, and curricula. Okay, I will show the question. There are specific and concrete examples of how the heritage sites practices have been used to improve learning environments, contents, and curricula. In Petra, for example, a set of cultural education programs are held for youth, women, PWDs and professionals. In Ecuador's case, several rooms of the museum plus a theater are used for education programs. In the case of Liverpool, the council's learning hub acts as a dynamic place for engaging people and introducing new heritage destinations. In Mexico's case, the milestone is met through the historical walks and museum night programs, which allow visiting several museums on the same night. Finally, our shared cultural heritage projects provide opportunities for skills development and sharing at heritage sites. So this goes on for all the 17 questions. A brief explanation is provided to summarize the written answers, and sometimes key notes are highlighted. This is another example for a checkbox question and a column chart answer, a column chart diagram. Well, ideally, all the design questions should have been shared with various countries in selected regions to achieve the best results. Due to the high number of questions and the diverse content, and massive collaborations between different departments was needed to collect the requested data. It is therefore recommended to share the survey with the organizations that work on a national level who have better access to data and can follow up the, through ICOMOS and can be followed up through ICOMOS national committees. Otherwise, there is a risk of developing ineffective indicators and wasting resources and capacity. And just final notes. Although many frameworks have addressed developing indicators for heritage contribution to the SDGs, there is still no comprehensive framework on this matter that addresses all the goals. Practitioners and policymakers should consider a document like the policy guidance at the earliest stage of their heritage projects, because it's important to have the baseline data to evaluate the contribution of the project to the SDGs after its completion. Although the impacts of heritage on the SDGs are well recognized at present, mapping heritage projects against SDGs provide an exceptional opportunity to support this statement with concrete evidence. There's a wealth of identified heritage projects that highly contribute to the SDGs. Drawing on this project can save a lot of time and energy and provide a basis to test the indicators. This project provides tangible evidence on how heritage is interconnected with various fields and disciplines, including development, education, economy, etc. Thank you all for your attention.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Ameneh. Really comprehensive study, you know, really taking the policy guidance and moving it forward, and I'm sure this is really, really useful for the next phase of the policy guidance, and also a really great comprehensive overview of what is valuable for local organizations and local site managers. So thank you so much for your work. It's been a real pleasure working with you, and we hope to work with you more in the future. So please give Ameneh a round of applause. Well, thank you both, Ameneh and Lydia, so much for your presentations. Very different work, but both very, very useful. And we're really thrilled that you were able to do this work, you know, with us at the SDGs Working Group. So just to move us right along, I will share my screen again, and we will finish up with our last presentations. Or actually, Ilari, what do you think? Would it be easier just to introduce the different participants so everyone can see their video?
Oops. Yeah, indeed. I think that's a very good idea. Maybe we could start with Tanya. And well, since as the other, so she's the new intern of the SDGs Working Group, but she has just started a project. So Tanya, please, the floor is yours.
Hi, everyone. Just a brief introduction of myself. My name is Tanya Kostrucci. I'm a graduate student in World Heritage Studies program at the Brandenburg University of Technology. My background is actually in classical archaeology, which I received my master's from Université de Montréal. I recently begun my internship with ICOMOS SDG Working Group under the mentorship of Christophe Rivet, the president of ICOMOS Canada. Part of my internship will be learning about the practical application of sustainable development goals and heritage conservation in the private sector. We've recently begun working, we're preparing a working plan for the projects. The projects will be helping with, well, I'll be helping with, have really multifaceted issues that need multifaceted solutions. And it's our goal to make heritage a prominent solution with the implementation of the SDGs. One of the projects is located in Montreal, Quebec, that will include a heritage and sustainability analysis of the downtown area. We'll be working with a group that represents Montreal's economic interests and also involved in the city's policymaking. And what's really encouraging about this group is their commitment to sustainable approaches to revitalize the downtown area. During my internship with the SDG Working Group, I'll also be working with Task Team 7 with Anashia and Ilaria, looking at fundraising and mentorship while focusing on sustainable initiatives. I'll be helping the team research funding strategies and how to better support emerging professionals at ICOMOS. As an ICOMOS intern, I'll also be sharing my results of the lessons learned from my internship through a final report, as well as one or two social media posts that will be posted during throughout my internship. In order to illustrate the value, not only for myself as an intern, but also for ICOMOS, to be part of such an opportunity to work on concrete cases in urban environments and the practicalities and realities of applying SDGs in the private sector. So hopefully it can further encourage discussions on cultural heritage and sustainable development goals. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tanya. Very interesting. Looking forward to hearing the updates throughout your project and working together, of course, within the Task Team 7 scope of work. Then afterwards, we'd like to hear the feedback of the mentors. So to hear the experience from, the other parties involved in this internship program. Maybe we can start with Gabe, who was the mentor of Lydia during her internship placement.
Yes. So for me and Lydia, it was, I thought it was a very good internship. In the beginning, to be honest, I had a different perspective of where the research is going. The initial research was focused on how the SDGs were crafted and what is the World Heritage and Sustainable Development Policy and where it was going. But Lydia added in the value of climate action, and she really pushed her idea to this is a real issue that needs to be thought of. And I thought that that was a very really good move to deepen the research. So I thought it was a very collaborative process, and Lydia has done quite an extensive amount of work for the period of time. She has spoken to many commissioners and also UNESCO in the World Heritage Center. So congratulations, Lydia, for manning that meeting. And I do hope that you have a continued success. Now she's part of the US ICOMOS internship program. So we will be dealing with her more often soon. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gabe, for sharing your experience. And I think this is something that can be really useful to hear for everyone in the meeting today who might be interested in joining for next edition. Linda, would you like to share also your experience in mentoring Ameneh in the past 3 months?
So it was a wonderful and rewarding experience because I felt like I learned a lot. We were very ambitious. And frankly, I am amazed at the amount of work that Ameneh did. It was a huge task, and she approached it from a very well-structured, organized perspective. It was wonderful mentoring her, although I think maybe I learned much more from her. But it just goes to show that there is so much work that needs to be done, and that the policy guidance is, yes, it's a first step, but it's a very, very rich document. It has a lot of potential in it, and it really, really needs to be pushed forward and moved along. So for whoever else who is interested in mentoring, I would say that it is, it's a very, very rewarding experience, and it's wonderful for an older person to work with a younger person, because they have tons more energy. They bring a new perspective, and when the relationship works, it's a very good synergy. So it's a very rewarding experience. I highly recommend it. Thank you for the opportunity, actually. And thank you so much for ICOMOS USA to make it possible, because really without financial support, this amount of work would have been impossible.
Thank you very much, Linda, for sharing your experience and for creating this, it's very important bridge to our next presentation or introduction. So it's important to our minute never too much to stress how important was the collaboration with US ICOMOS and the International Exchange Program. As Gabe said, both Anasha and I were part of the program in the past years. We value it very much, and that's why we really wanted to establish this collaboration. So we're very happy to have here Zoe today to tell us something more about the program. The floor is yours, Zoe.
Thank you so much, and good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and thank you for all the wonderful presentations and for the opportunity to share more about the IEP. And also thank you to the SDG Working Group for hosting our interns this year. It's also such a great pleasure to see a few of our IEP alums on this call. I'm so sorry, my voice is breaking down for some reason today. But So my name is Zoe Lung, and I'm a trustee of the U.S. National Committee of ICOMOS, and I became chair of the IEP committee only in September, and I also concurrently chair the U.S. ICOMOS Emerging Professionals Network, and I'm also the representative for the U.S. and membership coordinator with ICOMOS EPWG, and I... As like many of you mentioned about this already, like I work closely with Lydia, who is now US ICOMOS new IEP EP coordinator to plan and implement both the IEP and EPN. Well, I don't have any slides. I thought that I would just like share some background information of the IEP program, and I look forward to a free flowing discussion afterwards. So first, I want to talk a little bit about like what we stand for. So at US ICOMOS, we see ourselves as a part of the global network of public and private institutions, and also people who support the conservation of world's heritage. So we've been established for over 50 years now, and have contributed to sharing best practices nationally and internationally, as well as promoting and driving conversations on things that we care about. So including indigenous rights, climate change, and racial justice. So and social justice. So it remains the only US preservation organization with a global focus. And the IEP is actually the longest running program at US ICOMOS, established back in 1984. As ICOMOS also serves as, it's like an expert advisor to the World Heritage Committee the World Heritage Program is an important part of our work. So all but five of the 24 World Heritage Sites in the US are managed by the National Park Service. And in the history of the IEP program, we have had many participants placed with the National Park Service, but mostly at the offices for documentation and projects rather than, you know, at the sites themselves. But this is like going to change in the future. Not only, so I mentioned that the program is the longest running program at US ICOMOS. It's also the only program within the organization that engages with emerging professionals in multiple disciplines related to heritage preservation. So each year, a little bit about program. So the structure of it is it provides paid opportunities to graduate students and young professionals for 12 weeks during the summer. So usually from June through August. That would include the orientation and final program in Washington, D.C., where the U.S. ICOMOS is headquartered. So traditionally, we place U.S. interns in overseas hosts and international interns in U.S. hosts. So and since 1984, over 700 interns have been placed in over 70 countries in the world, including the United States. So the program not only contributes to sharing best cultural heritage preservation practices from the US and around the world, but also it highlights the importance of personal and communal benefits of international cultural engagement and exchange. So, and the program, so usually I'm getting into a little bit in the weeds, and the program starts with an orientation, usually involving a lot of meetings and site visits over 3 or 4 days that help people understand the US practices and approach to preservation. And interns then travel to their various host locations where they complete a 10-week long preservation related project designed by the host organization. And at the end of summer, all interns gather back in Washington, D.C. for about 3 or 4 days again for a final debriefing and also a farewell program before we send them off to their respective location and homes. So during the 10 weeks period, we also support and mentor the interns during their internship period. And really this year is the first year we have remote internships. So I'm very interested in learning what you all think and how we can improve the experience and outcomes going forward. So the other thing I want to mention is about the participants. So although we say that we target emerging professionals in the international exchange program, but actually over the years, we have selected many interns who have worked many years, even like decades of experience, and were in a career transition looking to boost their CVs and by participating in the IEP. I think like the way that I see where the IEP is going is that, you know, it's really just a platform to support and help provide the exchange experience to learn maybe another country's cultural heritage system for students and professionals from all countries at all stages of their career and also from all disciplines. So I see it as a broader kind of like mandate. And each year, since I've been on the IEP committee for five or six years now, so each year we come together, the members of the IEP committee come together and match interns with the host organizations. I told Lydia about this. It's a really rigorous process. It's as we usually have five or six times at least, you know, more intern applicants than host organizations. So what we do is like we read through all applicants' materials everything really to understand the applicants' motivations, sometimes even their life stories. And then we go through their portfolios, even like it involves really long like history papers and studies. And I love this process because I learned so much from this too, like from everyone's like what they're doing, what they're passionate about. And I'm always so inspired by our applicants. And so we go through all of the materials and then do, to make sure that we come up with the best match between our host organization's proposed project and also the individual's backgrounds and skills. So the result of these tens of hours of work, both working individually ourselves and also like collaboratively within the committee, is a consensus among us on the final ranked choices for each host organization. And then we then reach out to the hosts and explain our proposed choice and usually our first choice. And sometimes it's different because the process can get really complicated when there's someone we really, really want to place and they could be ideal for more than one organization, one host or project. So in that case, we may stagger our outreach and to host to make sure that we can place that person. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to get into the weeds too much in this, but I guess I just stopped there. I see so many like alignments, you know, of what we all want to do and what we're doing. And I look forward to hearing your ideas and exploring more collaborations and synergies. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Zoe. Congratulations for the program. It's fantastic, and I mean it's there for such a long time. I hope that in a few years we'll be able to say the same about the SDGs Working Group Internship Program, and this is just the beginning of our long collaboration. then maybe Gabe, would you like to chat the rest of the program with the presentations? Yeah.
Oh, I think there were questions to Lydia and Ameneh to the chat. Do you want to, Lydia and Ameneh, do you want to respond to those questions? I think one was from...
I've actually been recording the questions on a separate document here, so it might just be easier. I'm just going to grab them from the chat as they come. We currently have four questions in our chat. So starting with the first one for Lydia, this is from Ege. And she asks, why do you think climate action, the SDGs, are not fully integrated? Is SDG 13 an insufficient policy tool? Is it somehow sidelined by COP?
Wow.
Sorry, it's the provocative one.
I don't know about COP. And I have to say, I haven't put that much thought into it. But in terms of, I think one of the reasons is because it's its own SDG. It's kind of pinned as one of many, and so I don't think it's given quite as much attention, which is why I was trying to focus it on integrating it generally within all of them. I don't think it should be its own SDG. I think it should be more broadly viewed, and I think that's why I think that answers your question, but I'm not sure.
Maybe Lydia, we can add on that one of the things that were came out of the research is that the climate action is ad hoc. I think Lydia mentioned that. So right now, the focus of World Heritage Management plans are always focused on, OUV management, but it's not really looking at the bigger picture of climate action. So having that to the picture, bringing that to the picture of World Heritage Management can allow for a stronger climate action and more deliberate. I think that's what I thought. Yeah.
Can I ask with a follow-up question? Do you think that the World Heritage Climate Change Policy that was just renewed, do you think that helps?
Lydia can
I think
answer.
It does. Yeah. But one of the key issues that, and this was something that UNESCO brought up, is that the OUV is still an ongoing discussion as to what happens for loss of OUV, and that is something that still needs to be addressed, because that's something that climate change will very much affect And yeah, UNESCO has agreed that it's an ongoing discussion that they haven't quite settled yet.
Yeah, because the idea of OUV, right? Let's say the Great Barrier Reef, if the with the continuous changes that are happening, then there is a possibility that, let's say, biodiversity is no longer in the coral reef. So the question of will it still be World Heritage is a question. So that's where these kinds of finer points needs to be discussed. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thanks, Ege. I'll actually get Ege's next question to Ameneh. I'll just go bounce back and forth between the two interns. Ege's question to Ameneh is, how would this contribution relate to UNESCO 2030 thematic indicators?
Well, as I remember, there were four themes under the UNESCO 2030 thematic indicators. I found it very interesting, and I'm sure that there was a lot of knowledge and experience behind it. But to be honest, I thought that I don't have the knowledge to come up with some thematic indicators, and I chose easier way, and I just designed indicators for each policy statement. At some point, I was tempted to use these themes. But as I said, I wasn't sure if I am capable, and I didn't want to just copy these things, and I couldn't come up with new things. So that's it.
May I also say something on this as a follow-up? You know, as Linda said, and I think everyone agrees, you already did a tremendous amount of work. I mean, that's not out of the question. You know, I don't think that's the topic, but I think you also said that, you know, there are many frameworks trying to measure. And I mean, this is a very excellent work that will be, that is, if we promote it, it can be accepted into the literature as the next framework, one of many other frameworks. And then we have the problem of fragmented frameworks. And how to mainstream it and get it more like visible and legitimate, let's say, and used around. One way to do that would be actually to tie in somehow into the UNESCO system, maybe. That's why I'm thinking pragmatically, if we actually take our work and show how it could actually be like a satellite or an offshoot, like a zoom in into a part of those UNESCO thematic indicators, then UNESCO will take it more seriously and use it. I don't know, I mean, Gabe knows better because you guys are working on those relations right now. But just to put a piece of the puzzle into the bigger picture of frameworks, then it makes your valuable work even more appreciated. So that's why I'm just asking how it could be tied into it. I don't know if you agree.
I totally agree, because there are some common points in these policy statements and as well as in the indicators. And I think if we follow up thematic, designing thematic indicators, we can remove these the things that are similar in these indicators and come up with something more eligible.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question is from Linda, and it's to Lydia. She says, what is the timeline for these strategies for each site? In other words, when were they implemented?
That's a tricky one, because some of them, there wasn't any clarity as to if they were being implemented, if they had been implemented. A lot of that was based off of the site manager interviews on what they say they were doing and what had been done. Because a lot of the management plans, so like the one of the management plans was from 2015 to 2019. And then when asked how much of the management plan had been accomplished, they said, well, only some of it. So that is a key point of difficulty. A lot of what I derived as like some of the key actions were based on site manager interviews rather than in the management plan themselves. And all of the actions that I spoke to were then revised by the site managers to ensure that I was speaking about them correctly, that they had or had not happened. But the timelines were very loose, and there wasn't necessarily a defined timeline as to when they were happening or if they were happening, to answer your question.
Can I ask, can I say something and follow up to Lydia? Lydia, a lot of your work shows a very interesting correlation with local strategies and policies. And I think that perhaps a next step to push your research forward would be to map what policies and strategies were being introduced or implemented by the government that aligned with what was happening or what issues were being pushed or supported by the management plan, because then you can really make a close relationship between how heritage is impacted by policy and how there can be an interaction between the two to support future policy agendas.
That's a good point. And that's a very interesting, because you're right, how much of it is affected by policy? That was not something that was in the scope of my research. So how much of that is local initiative versus policy would be an interesting angle. Yeah.
Thanks for your work, by the way.
I think, Lydia, there's something that we could take up for the new IEP internship for the SDG survey. Okay, Anasha, so is it okay if we carry on with the next part? Yeah,
I think those are all the questions we have so far to the interns, Lydia and Ameneh. If you have any further questions for them on their work, please feel free to reach out to them directly. Once again, thank you both so much. Thank you, Gabe. Thank you, Linda. It has been a really fun experience. It's been a great program, and we're excited for next year. Yeah. Thank you all very much.